Over 40 years ago, Dr. J. Vernon McGee said that lawlessness is growing and will finally break out until it actually is world revolution. However, lawlessness isn't new in our day. It began with the fall of man in Genesis chapter 3, and according to Scripture, it will culminate in the person of the Antichrist during the Great Tribulation. So our Bible teacher, Dr. J. Vernon McGee, is going to take us to 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 7, and elaborate on the issue of the mystery of iniquity. Dr. McGee first gave this sermon at the historic Church of the Open Door in downtown Los Angeles, where he served for 21 years. Although it was given sometime in the mid-60s, his teachings still stand true today because they're based on the eternal truth of the Word of God. Before we get to our sermon, though, let's hear from some of our listeners. This first letter comes to us from Seams, Alabama. The listener writes, "I am writing with thanks and gratitude for the tremendous blessing this radio program provides. I'm a stay-at-home mother, and I listen each morning in my kitchen as I go about taking care of my boys at home. The broadcast is part of our day, so much that even my three-year-old knows the sound of Dr. McGee's voice, and as he sweetly puts it, Mommy, that man talks about God. I look forward to reading the passages each day and then listening to what God reveals through the teaching of His powerful Word. God revealed many new truths to me through the study of 1 and 2 Chronicles. I found these books filled with comforting illustrations that God is sovereign, His purpose prevails, and His mercies endure. Furthermore, I never lose my thrill and fascination with the Bible and how it is even more up-to-date than tomorrow's headlines. As I studied the rise and fall of all the kings mentioned in Chronicles, I began to see just a small glimpse of how God must see our own nation. I pray for revival to sweep our country and repentance to seep into the hearts of our leaders. I praise God for leading me to this vibrant ministry as I ride along on the Bible bus." This next letter comes from a listener in Eden Prairie, Minnesota. She writes, "Dr. McGee's radio broadcast played an important role when I first became a Christian a little over 31 years ago. It is a pleasure to listen to him again in such a convenient fashion through the online broadcasts at oneplace.com. I can listen to him as I am able. I pray others will find them online as I did. I also told a friend at work about oneplace.com. It's hard to find good teaching that fits with the work schedules. This fills the need for people like us." Our next letter comes from a listener in Visalia, California. "I've listened on and off since 1962 when I was brought back to the Lord through Dr. McGee's teaching in Romans. I learned about my sins, also about God's grace and how I could be righteous before Him. I went to a Bible school, but it was very limited in what it could do. It was from Dr. McGee's books and teaching that I gained what Bible knowledge I have. I have been a pastor for about 26 years, and it has been the Through the Bible study that has been my resource. I listen to the program on the internet and am glad that it is there. I am a 72-year-old man, and here we are back in Romans. How refreshing. How blessed I have been down through the years." And then our next letter is from a listener in Watertown, Massachusetts, who says, "I first started listening to Dr. McGee when he was still on this earth. I was going through a rough time, a bad relationship, drug abuse, and his shows were a comfort. I am now happily married for 16 years, free of cocaine for almost 20 years, and your ministry is my favorite by far. The good doctor's voice is pleasing to me, even as raspy and twangy as it is. I hope my gifts to you, as intermittent as they are, help to reach many for Christ. I'm not a very strong soldier for the Lord on a one-to-one basis, so I do try to give to those who are, in hope of making the grace that God has shown to me useful for others. Thank you very, very much for your work." We come now, this one is a letter from Norwalk, California, and this person wrote, "I'm 23 years old. I wanted to say that your program has helped me so much in my walk with the Lord. Trying to live as God wants you to live, you come to the point where you need instruction to help be different from this perverse world. I found that help with your program. I enjoy the solid teaching of Dr. J. Vernon McGee. What a blessing he is. May your program continue to reach many souls, especially the youth. Here is my humble offering that I know God will multiply, and I trust you will use for the sake of His kingdom. I know it's not much, but I'm single, living on my own, and trying to help other ministries that are also reaching this world. Thank you, and may God continue to use you all." And now let's pray. Heavenly Father, as lawlessness abounds, we pray that your grace may abound even more, bringing people to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
You may want to turn with us to the second chapter of 2 Thessalonians. This is a chapter that Dr. John Walward says is one of the great prophetic chapters of the Scripture. And although I'm only going to lift out one verse this evening, I would like to read several verses, beginning with the very first one. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that the day of, not of Christ, but the day of the Lord. The day of Christ is the day in which we're living right now. The day of the Lord is that which actually begins with the great tribulation period. Joel says, the day of the Lord is not light, but darkness. It begins as the Hebrew day always began, at sundown. That's when God's day begins. And let me tell you, the great tribulation is sundown. It's darkness, but it ushers in the glorious day of the millennium. Now, that is what he's speaking of here. Nor by letter as from us, that the day of the Lord is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin, or that lawless one, be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that's called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And that to me is the most marvelous statement of all. If you go back in Acts, you'll find out Paul said he spent 3 Sabbath days in Thessalonica. That would mean he was there less than a month. And in a month's time, he gave them a course in theology that included eschatology. That certainly ought to answer these today who say that you ought not to teach the prophetic things to new believers. Well, Paul didn't know about that because he'd only been there for a month, and he'd founded the church in that time. They were all pagan when he got there. And now he's talking to them about these great things. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things, and now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth, and that's old Elizabethan, which actually means hinder, only he who now hindereth will hinder until he be taken out of the way. And without any attempt tonight to elaborate on that, I would like to say we believe that the hinderer is the Holy Spirit, and we believe that can be sustained, but that's not my purpose tonight. Verse 8, and then shall that wicked one be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. Now that's where I'd like to break off. Our subject this evening is the mystery of iniquity. Now ordinarily the subject of a sermon should shed some light on what is in the sermon, what is the content of it, what it's all about. But tonight I'm reversing that process, and in the sermon we want to try to explain what the subject is all about, the mystery of iniquity. And I'd like to look at that subject this evening. That is our message, actually. In verse 7 here, and this is the verse that we're looking at this evening, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now hindereth will hinder till he be taken out of the way. The mystery of iniquity. What did Paul mean by that expression? Well, the word mystery in the Greek, and it's used about 27 times in the New Testament, it does not mean anything that's mysterious. It has no reference to that at all. It's not a whodunit. It's not a Sherlock Holmes or a Mission Impossible TV program. It hasn't anything to do with that. It's not that kind of a mystery. And furthermore, it's not what cannot be known. It doesn't deal with the realm of the unknowable or the incomprehensible. Sometimes you hear folk use the expression like that, well, that's mysterious, or that's a mystery. And they mean by that that nobody can understand it. Well, that's not the way that it's used here. In fact, you will find that we have a scriptural definition, and Paul gives a scriptural definition for it, and I think we ought to look at his scriptural definition. It's over in Romans, the 16th chapter, and I'm reading two verses here, verses 25 and 26. Now, this is Paul's definition of a mystery as he uses it and as it is used in the New Testament. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. Now, Paul makes it very clear here what he means by a mystery. He says that this is something that back in the Old Testament was never revealed by the prophets. It wasn't a matter of revelation on their part. But Paul says now it is revealed, and it's revealed that all nations might know about it. Now, let me again turn to a passage that he gives further explanation of what he means by a mystery, because Paul defines his use of terms. In the third chapter of Ephesians, at verse 4, and I read, whereby, when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto the holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the people, by the gospel. Now, may I say that Paul here now gives a specific example of what he means by a mystery. And the church is a mystery in the sense that the church is not revealed in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, God's program was not to reach out into the world and call out Jews and Gentiles into a body that we call today the church. You don't have a church in the Old Testament. God dealt with the nation Israel, and through the nation Israel, he reached the nations of the world. The Queen of Sheba came from the ends of the earth. She's merely one example of many, because the book of Acts merely gives examples, and we know that, well, actually, there were 8,000 people saved there in Jerusalem, just like that, probably the first week of the church. And we have only three examples given to us of conversions that were outstanding. Now, the Queen of Sheba's merely one. Multitudes of people came to know God through the witness of the nation Israel in Jerusalem. They never went out to the ends of the earth. I've had great sympathy with Jonah. Jonah, we speak of him being a backslidden prophet, and he was, but he could have talked back to God and said, look here, you never sent Jeremiah out. You never sent any of these other prophets out to witness, and why are you sending me out? This is something brand new. Now, may I say to you that today, Paul says, that God now is no longer dealing with the nation Israel as such. They've been set aside, and God now, out of Jew and Gentile, he's calling a people out of the world. And he's been doing that for 1,900 years. It's very interesting. When Paul said this, It would be very easy for an enemy to stand up and say, "We don't believe this, Paul. God will go right on with the Jewish nation." I'm sure some must have said it. And it'll continue as it has. You could have said it because this minority group that's called the church were really a minority group. But may I say to you that 1900 years now witness to the fact that this is exactly what God was doing and is doing today and will continue to do until he takes the church out of the world. Now, therefore, a mystery is something that was not revealed in the Old Testament, but it is revealed in the New Testament. Therefore, a mystery is not something concealed, it's something revealed. It's very opposite of what we think that it is. The mystery of iniquity. Now, will you look at this word iniquity with me for just a few moments? The Greek word here is anomia, and nomia means law. When you put an alpha in front of any Greek word, you make a negative of it. I don't care what it is. You reverse its meaning. It may be going down the freeway this way, but when you put an alpha there, you put it on the other side of the freeway and start it back the opposite direction. And nomia means law. When you put the alpha there, anomia means lawless. And it's actually, the word is lawlessness. And it's interesting to note that this word is used 11 times in the New Testament. And there are 11 mysteries in the New Testament. And this word is used 11 times. I do not mean by saying that there's any type of correlation that should be made. Now, the word iniquity here means lawlessness, the mystery of lawlessness. And Paul is saying here that the mystery of lawlessness was something that was not developed in the Old Testament at all. You have a tremendous outbreak at the time of the flood, and God deals with it in judgment. But here is a mystery of lawlessness that was beginning to work in Paul's day and will continue to work until the very end of the age. And as it does, it snowballs. As it goes down the hill, it gathers momentum and size until it breaks out in world revolution. That is the way that he presents it. Now, there's some things to be said about this lawlessness, and it's that I want to deal with this evening. The first is this, that it's not necessarily confusion and disorder. It's not necessarily that kind of lawlessness. It was the aim of Satan from the very beginning to overthrow divine government in the universe. In other words, it was organized confusion on his part. And it was directed disorder. It's planned agitation. It was blueprint of revolution, if you please. Paul speaks of that over here in the sixth chapter of Ephesians when he speaks of the fact that we are today working against an enemy, and he makes it very clear that this enemy is a spiritual enemy. He says in Ephesians 6, verse 10, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles," or the methodia, "of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the world rulers of this darkness, against spiritual wickedness in high places." A tremendous organization, satanic organization, supernatural organization that attempts to overthrow God's law in his universe. And that's the reason that today that you find that there is an attack being made upon what is known as the Judeo-Christian ethic. You and I live in a world today that the civilized world recognizes marriage. Where did it come from? Well, it came from the Word of God. That's God's arrangement for the human family. It was the very beginning when he brought Adam and Eve together. Now we have in the world today this spirit that says, let's get rid of marriage. The hippies are getting rid of it. And I do not have the clipping tonight because I intend to deal with that subject later on. But San Francisco's getting mighty sick of them, I can tell you that. At first, they were tolerant and smile. And I have an article written by one of the attorneys up there who's very sick of them. He says that they are no longer the little loving flower children. He says now they are becoming hard, their language is becoming hard, their lives are becoming hard, and their drugs are becoming hard. They're living that kind of a life today. And it's becoming an awful thing, and today the thing that characterizes them, he says, is dirty language and dirty bodies, filthy in their living, filthy in everything. What is this spirit today? It's a spirit of lawlessness that is satanic. Let's get rid of God. The second psalm has a tremendous message that begins with that awful undertone and overtone. Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain and thing, an empty thing, something that'll never reach fulfillment? What is it that's brought them together? The kings of the earth come together, and the rulers set themselves against the Lord and against His anointed, His Messiah, His Christ. They're against God and Christ, yes. Let us break their bands asunder. Let's cast their cords from us. What's bands? Well, the Ten Commandments are there. The Judeo-Christian ethic. God doesn't have the church under law, but God does have a law for the universe, and He has a moral law for man today. And the Bible has had its effect upon the world today. Where do you get the idea, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not tell a lie, bear false witness? It comes from the Word of God, my beloved. Now today they say, let's ditch all of that. Let's get rid of it. Now, of course, communism has been doing it for years because they got rid of God. Now, all over today. And this matter of lawlessness is spreading everywhere. Now, that's one of the features of it. And the interesting thing about it is, although the mystery of lawlessness is not a subject of the Old Testament, it's not new. Did you notice how Paul expressed it? For the mystery of lawlessness doth already work. It was working in Paul's day. And it is pyramiding up, as we said a moment ago. It's snowballing. It just keeps going. And finally, it will break like a mighty crescendo upon the human family, this matter of rebellion against Almighty God. It'll continue to work. And you see it working today. John, in his epistle, speaks as there are already many antichrists. And what he means by that, there's been some question whether he means a system or an individual. It doesn't make any difference how you interpret it. You have to come up with the same answer, that there are already many antichrists. There is that which is against Christ that's been working. And it began way back in John's day and in Paul's day. And it will finally be headed up in this man that Paul here identifies as the lawless one. The man of sin, it means the lawless one. It's the one that heads it up. In other words, the sin of man that he committed in the Garden of Eden finally leads to the man of sin. And he will head up all of this that's lawlessness, the thing that characterizes, man of sin, or the lawless one, as it's more accurate to describe him, is that he is against God and opposed to everything that is against God. He'll be the acme and the epitome of lawlessness, yet there's a very strange thing. He'll be able to control it for his own ends. Peter speaks of these days in the second epistle of Peter, where he speaks, they promise them liberty, but they themselves are in bondage. And to me, one of the saddest things, all over Market Street in San Francisco are these hippies, and they are the worst look. I thought they were bad looking a year ago. They have gotten uglier as they've gone along. I saw some, I give you my word, that if you'd meet them at night, you'd be frightened. They were frightful looking. And they're selling papers. They've now apparently got one paper. I didn't buy it, but a little fella came up to me. He's very pasty-faced, obviously on dope, and doesn't mind saying that he is. He does not live in the Haight-Ashbury section at all. I talked to him quite a bit there. He was very talkative, very sad, very unhappy. And I asked him the point blank question. I said, you have, he has left apparently a very good home. His people apparently father and mother, they're prosperous people. And he's not poverty stricken by any means. And he left all of that. And his idea was he could be free, at liberty. And I asked him about it, the dope. I said, are you happy? And he said, no, I'm not. I said, are you on dope? And he said, yes. And I said, have you passed the marijuana and the LSD stage? He said, I sure have. I said, why don't you get off of it? He said, I can. I said, I thought you came up here to have liberty. And you've come up here to have liberty, and you can't get off of it. That's not liberty. They promised them liberty. May I say that heading up in a lawless one who finally will control it, by the way, that would be the amazing thing about it. Now, there's another aspect of this lawlessness that is very strange, that's obvious in our day, and it's frightening. It's truly frightening. And it is a sign of the last day, and that is that this lawlessness has religious roots. It has the complexion of Christianity. It has church connection. That's the amazing thing about it. There was a time when the church stood for law and order. You could expect the ministers of a community to back up the law officials. I was amazed when Chief Parker died, and I just made a statement here concerning him. I was amazed to get from a police official that I was the only preacher, as far as they knew, had ever said anything good about his death. May I say to you, what a tragic hour we've come to find ministers today taking the other side and defending lawlessness today. And yet, that's exactly what the Word of God said would come to pass. Lawlessness today actually committed in the name of religion. And Paul speaks a great deal about having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. I'm not going to read this horrible brood that he mentions in 2 Timothy 4, or 3, I should say, men shall be lovers of self and all these things that are mentioned. Other than that, having a form of godliness, by the collar button in the back, they're supposed to be ordained ministers of the gospel, and yet they've denying the power of it. They've denied Christ, and this one is called the lawless one, the man of sin, the Antichrist. And he finally is headed up, a political leader and a religious leader, and he's all in one. And he's spoken of that way, of course, in the book of Revelation, in the 13th chapter. I do not know whether I should even take time to turn there, but let me do that tonight. The 13th chapter, and we have him presented there as the one that there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. He opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle, them that dwell in heaven. And candidly, friends, we've had a great deal of blasphemy in the past few years, but I don't think it's anything to what you're going to hear this next year and the years that lie ahead. I think there's going to be a repudiation of God and the Word of God, the like of which that we've never heard or seen of. And I'm of the opinion that'll be one of the things that'll bring God on the scene, because I'm not sure he's going to permit man to continue to blaspheme him. He's always moved in judgment in the past. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints, to overcome them. And power was given unto him over all kindreds and tongues and nations, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life. Now, you'll notice that he's a political leader, but he's also a religious leader. He's worshiped. You have the wedding of the church and state. You have the wedding of politics and religion. And he is a world dictator. He has power given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And it is in this direction, of course, that we are moving. Now, in the Word of God, in the last days, the apostasy in the church, immorality and lawlessness go together. It is the trinity of evil that go together in the last days. And there's a total finally a total breakdown of law and order, an absolute rejection of the Judeo-Christian ethic, and we're definitely moving in that direction. Now, that's not confined to Los Angeles or to this country or San Francisco, but it's something today that's worldwide. We're seeing it now break out in France. It's ready to break out. I've been over this country quite a bit now in the past year. In fact, I've been to every section of it. And there's an ugly mood in America right now, an ugly mood underneath. It's not against anything apparently in particular other than it just against. Just against God in the final analysis. This awful rebellion that's in the human heart today, a breaking out satanic in its inception, of course. Now, the involvement, therefore, of ministers of organized church in civil disobedience and acts of lawlessness is one of the tragic and strange quirks of this age. Shakespeare has a character in Hamlet say, "The times are out of joint." Well, you and I are living in a day when the times are out of joint, when men with a clerical garb, collar button in the back, sitting and marching with the hippies, and that's a common sight today on TV. We are living in days of lawlessness, my beloved. Columbia University, a great university, closed by a lawless gang. Berkeley campus, a great university, crawling with this vermin like a dog with fleas today. May I say to you how tragic the plight, not only of America, but of the world tonight. Caught up in a spirit of lawlessness, that which the Word of God said would come. I have other clippings here that might reveal to you something of this tragic situation. And I'm not discussing politics tonight, I'll not even mention any candidate by name here, but I have an article by James Reston. I think he's been made the new editor of the New York Times, a brilliant but a liberal commentator. But listen to him. He says, "What's wrong here is that none of the presidential candidates has the answer to the problems of the nation. If you read the political news these days, it's hard to escape the conclusion that nobody is fit to be president. Each candidate, in turn, describes our problems in such depressing terms that he inevitably eliminates himself as the man to solve them." Then he mentions the candidates. And then Joseph Kraft, in his tremendous article, and he closes it like this: "Looking toward the future in these circumstances, it's hard to resist a sense of despair. It's not simply, as Yeats put it in some famous lines, that the center cannot hold, but a kind of mental and moral decay is eating out the vitals of the country. And for my part, I do not see how the nation can ever recover the routine of the life that was what used to be normality." May I say that anywhere you turn today, you will find there is pessimism throughout the world as to the future, that there is no solution to the problem of lawlessness. The Word of God said it was coming. I do not mean to even infer tonight that this is a fulfillment of prophecy. I'm merely saying that lawlessness is growing just as the Word of God said it would. It will finally break out until it actually is world revolution. The Word of God says that. But you know, God is going to handle it. I want to turn to God's answer and His solution for this. I turn to the Sermon on the Mount, 7th chapter, verse 21. Listen to the Lord Jesus. "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out demons, and in thy name done many wonderful works?" Listen to this. "And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." That's our word. "Ye that work lawlessness." He said that he'll judge lawlessness in a very special way. And because lawlessness is abounding, the Lord Jesus said in the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24:12, "And because lawlessness," that's our word in the translation is iniquity. And because iniquity or lawlessness shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. We today are receiving over 4,000 letters a month on our radio. We've had a phenomenal increase. And it more or less gives you a feeling of the pulse across this land today. And I've noted certain letters that have come in. There is a feeling of hopelessness and helplessness that's settling down on America tonight. Many Christians feel like giving up. They say, what can you do? Nothing in the world to do. Well, now, what should be the attitude of the Christians? And I'd like to close with that this evening. Well, I want to say this. It should not be a defeatist attitude. I do not know about you, but I personally would rather live right now than any period in the history of the world. I've said that many times, and I'll continue to say it. These are great days to live in. Listen to the Lord Jesus over in the 21st chapter of Luke. Speaking of these days, that is, days that were coming, verse 26, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your head, for your redemption draweth nigh. There are two things today. I think that right now is the most marvelous time in the history of the world to get the word out. I rejoice in the privilege we have today of getting the word out. It's the greatest day, the greatest opportunity we've ever had. We are actually besieged today by radio stations that want our program to go on. This teaching of the Bible, somehow or another, has caught on. There are a lot of people hungry today and want the word. May I say to you, I rejoice in being able to live today. I think it's a great day to live, great day. I wouldn't exchange days with anyone. Then there's another thing. We today do not have the correct perspective. We're looking at the present, and there are too many people saying, oh, as I look about me today, things are coming apart. They're coming unglued, and nothing you can do. Well, my friend, John Calvin used to put it like this. He said, I'd rather lose now and win later than win now and lose later. I'm on the side that's going to win. And God can afford to wait. I can't, but he can. And he's going to ultimately win. And if you want the perspective of history, go back and look in the Roman Empire in the first century. There's a little Jew that's been arrested in Rome. He's the missionary to the Gentiles, and it looks as if Christianity now will be stopped dead in its tracks, and it will only be a local religion in Judea. You watch it. They bring him before Agrippa, and Agrippa comes in there in all of his robes, and Paul is brought in all of his chains. And you look at that and you say, this is the end. But you haven't seen it, friend, because this man, Paul, doesn't defend himself. He doesn't need to. Paul is trying to win Agrippa, and Agrippa finally has to cry out, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. Paul says, not almost, but altogether. I wish that you were just like I am, except these bonds. But if you'll read under the lines, you'll find out Paul says, Agrippa, you really got bonds on you. He was an alcoholic. He was overwhelmed by the sex of his day. May I say to you, old Agrippa was really the one in the bonds of slavery. Paul was the free man. Follow him on over to Rome. The man on the throne is a madman by the name of Nero. Paul is the only one that's making sense right then in the Roman Empire. You want the judgment of history on that? 1900 years have gone by, and men today, they name their sons Paul, and they call their dogs Nero. Why? That's the judgment of history. And you and I are living in a day of lawlessness. God says it was coming. And then the thing that is frightening, though, is that you and I, as we sit right here tonight, we have lawlessness in our hearts. Did you know that? We're that kind of creatures. Will you listen to Paul now in closing? In the 8th chapter of Romans, Paul says, because the carnal mind, that's this old nature, the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. the hippie, the lawless crowd are doing exactly what they do by nature. They can't do otherwise. They think they're free. For it's not subject, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. It's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. And when man is given this liberty today that he's talking about, what does he do? He does what comes naturally. He rebels against God. The Word of God says, and I'll give only one verse of Scripture, that's Hebrews 10, verse 17. God says, and their sins and their iniquities, there's our word again, and their sins and their lawlessnesses will I remember no more. Because I sent my Son into that world of rebellion, and they took him and crucified him. But God said, I made his very death the altar on which the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world was offered. And when Peter stood up there on the day of Pentecost, he said it was done by the foreknowledge and the determinate counsel of God, but you did it with wicked hands. But God can save, because he died to take out of your heart that lawlessness and bring you into obedience to the Son of God.
How about you? Are you going along with the crowd that's in rebellion against God, refusing to have Christ rule in your life? Instead of following the pack, why not yield your heart and mind to God? Will you come to him today and receive Jesus Christ as your Savior? If you'd like more information on God's plan of salvation for your life, we'd like to send you our salvation packet. To receive yours, just call us at 1-800-65-BIBLE anytime, leaving a voicemail request. The title of Dr. McGee's sermon today was The Mystery of Iniquity, and it's available as an individual CD. If you'd like more information on the Antichrist, then you may also be interested in Dr. McGee's booklet, Who is Antichrist? For ordering information on this item, you can also contact one of our service operators at 1-800-65-BIBLE, Monday through Thursday, from 6 a.m. to 3 p.m. Pacific Time. Now, this week on the Through the Bible radio program, we'll be returning to the Old Testament and beginning Dr. McGee's study in the prophetic book of Jeremiah. So if you'd like to study along with Dr. McGee as he uses the prophecies of Jeremiah to speak to our hearts today, then you'll want to contact us for our notes and outlines on the book of Jeremiah. You can do that, again, by simply calling 1-800-65-BIBLE. You can also download them for free, or you can use our internet order form at ttb.org. And, of course, you can always write to Sunday Sermon. For those in the U.S., Box 7100. Pasadena, California, 91109. In Canada, Box 25325. London, Ontario, N6C, 6B1. Now we pray that the Lord will fill you with his grace, mercy, and peace.
Jesus made it home. Unto him I owe. Sin hath left a crimson stain.
This program has been brought to you by the faithful friends and supporters of Through the Bible Radio Network.